Don't ever let somebody tell you you can't do something. Not even me. All right?
All right.
You got a dream, you got to protect it. People can't do something themselves. They want to tell you you can't do it. You want something, go get it. Period.
Which Will Smith do you want to be in that clip? Do you want to be the one at the beginning or the one at the end? Rhetorical. You can answer if you want. You want to be the one at the end or the one at the beginning? If you and I want to improve our voices, whether that is a typed voice, a texted voice, a spoken voice, if you and I want to improve our voices, then there's no other place to start than the person who created your mouth. You know, your mouth was invented by God himself. He's like, need something else on the face, the eyes, the nose, a mouth. And then he gave you a mouth. It was God's idea. So if you want to know how something works, you ask the person who invented it. So let's ask God. How do we ask God anything and find out what he thinks about something? We look in the scriptures. In this case, the book of Proverbs. We're just going to have a Proverbs dump. You ready? You can read along with me if you'd like. Let's pop the first one up there. Proverbs 4:23. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Proverbs 18:21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. Proverbs 31:26. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. Proverbs 13:3. Whoever guards his mouth preserves his life. He who opens wide his lips comes to ruin. Yikes. Proverbs 12:18. There is one whose rash words are like sword thrusts, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. One more. Proverbs 15:28. The heart of the righteous ponders how to answer, but the mouth of the wicked pours out evil things. Today, for the sake of argument, we're just going to look at two different things, two extremes of the things that come out of our mouth or come off our fingers or come out of our keyboard. Two different extremes, poison and honey. And we're going to talk about reverse engineering. Have you ever heard this term? Reverse engineering. You take the final product and then you look backwards to see what kind of system could be put into place to create that product. You see a fully functioning watch and you go, okay, let's reverse engineer the watch. We'll take it all apart and we'll see how it works, and then we'll know how to create a fully functioning watch. We're going to talk about poison words, honey words, how our words are manufactured at all. We're going to reverse engineer it. Got it? Got it?
Yeah.
Awesome. Now, first and foremost, I need to show you. I've had some fun this week trying to come up with good visuals, as usual. Here's poison. If you didn't tell, if you couldn't tell already, there's poison. And this is, yeah, you guys are smart. This I got at Target in the poison section. This is from Publix, but I'm not telling you what's in there. I wouldn't drink it. Poison and honey. So, if we're going to put stuff into just two categories, well, let's define this a little bit. I also went to Walgreens. I think I found the biggest marker in the world. And I was like, how am I going to write stuff? And they're not going to be able to see it on Sunday. Operation Giant Marker. And I found, if I pass out, please call 911 because it is pungent, all right? Oh, look at that. Look at that. The big boy right there. Okay. Let's write some of these things. Poison things that could come out of someone's mouth. Honey things that might come out of someone's mouth. So here's a good one. Let's start with racism. Is racism poison or honey? Poison, exactly. Now, a honey thing might be this. Encourage. It's hard to write with a paintbrush. Okay. All right. So another poisonous thing might be this, hatred. How about a honey thing might be support. If you say supportive things to somebody else, that's a honey thing. Poisonous thing? Oh, you know someone who's like this? They so judgy. Judge, that's how you spell judgy, I guess, today. Does it need an E? Judgy. Why y'all so judgy? All right, so I feel like that sometimes. Why are you being judgy? How about love? Love is not poison. Love is honey. Or one more. How about this? Sarcasm. I told you about that at the beginning. Was that a positive thing that guy said to me coming out of the shower? No, but it was sarcasm. You picked a great time to take a shower, didn't you? Ooh, sarcasm. Usually poisonous. Honey, how about this? Joy. You know people that are more like these lists than the other? Here's what I want to know. Do you know anyone in your life? Let me put down big boy over here. Do you know anyone in your life? Anyone in your life? It could be someone you know very well. It could be someone you don't know very well. It could be a neighbor that lives down the street. I don't know. There are people I can imagine right now that are more like this than this. They are more poisonous than honey-ness, honey-ish. They are more this way than that way. Raise your hand if you know anyone in your life that is more this way than that, more negative than positive. Raise your hand. Interesting. There are 40% of you that know no one like this. That is amazing. I want your life. I want your life. This is participation here. You're getting a grade. Raise your hand now if there is anyone you can imagine or picture that is more like this. There's somebody you can picture. This is your great Aunt Lulu who lives in Kalamazoo. I don't know. She's always so supportive. Okay, so you can picture this. You can picture actual people that are those extremes. All right, here we're going to do an experiment. This is Science Day at Lake Forest. I'm going to need you to trust me and to close your eyes just for a moment. Just for a moment. Go ahead. Just close your eyes. Just for a moment. Everyone's got their eyes closed. Nobody cheating. I'm looking at you. I can see you. I want you to raise your hand for one of these two lists, and you have to raise your hand for one or the other. And all I want to know is if you lean more towards the poison list or if you lean more towards the honey list. It's not like every single thing out of your mouth is one or the other. But you, for the most part, just drip poison, whether it's the things you type, text, or say. So raise your hand if you are more on the poison side. Raise your hand. You must raise your hand for one or the other. Go ahead, raise your hand. I'm waiting. All right, hands down. That means if you are more on the honey side, you'll raise your hand now. It should be everybody else raising their hand. All right, hands down. What do you think about this data? What do you think it's going to tell us? You think it's 50-50? No. You think it's 50-50? No. Balcony, you think it's 50-50? No. You're right. Not even close. How can that be possible? It wasn't 50-50. It wasn't 60-40. It wasn't even 70-30. It was approximately, I'm going to say 7% raised their hand for poison and 93% honey. How can that be possible? It can't. It's because we are not being honest and we don't understand. We are not grasping the power of our words. We're not grasping the power of our words. Now, notice, I'm not just saying that you don't do this a lot. I'm saying that you actually do this. You are so supportive, encouraging, joyous, loving. I'm not just saying that you abstain from this. Does that make sense? I'm not saying who you aren't. I'm saying who you are. When people think of you, they go, thank God they're coming to the party. They are so amazing to be around. Is that what people think about you? Because you just said, I'm more honey. Okay, maybe that's true. But I think words have a lot more power than we're giving it credit for. Now, if only they would get their act together. If only they would get this figured out. If only they would quit with all the poison. If only they, it's never us. It's always them. If they could just, if those Republicans, if those Democrats, if those whatevers, if those, that's exhausting. Pointing to everybody else's problems. It sounds a lot like a scripture that says, why don't you take care of the plank in your own eye instead of, There is power in words. God spoke the universe into existence. He didn't wave a magic wand. He spoke the universe into existence. Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead with these words, come out, Lazarus. Jesus proclaimed our forgiveness with words. It is finished. You think words don't have power? You're mistaken. You think your words don't have more power than you're even giving them credit for? You're also mistaken. They do. They do. Guaranteed. And words can be poison. Words can be honey. But here's what I want us to not miss. I'm not talking about trying harder. Listen very carefully. I'm not talking about trying harder. I'm not talking about like just digging in deep and getting more willpower, reading more self-help books about how to be more positive. That's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is actually reverse engineering honey production inside of you. Not cutting off poison, but actually manufacturing honey. I'm not talking about just trying harder. Oh, just digging in, and oh, I'll figure this out one day. So if, like anything, we need to build a system. Guys, this week I got a little crazy, and I decided that I wanted to make a actual, why are you laughing? I eat your heart out, Bill Nye. I, or Dr. Seuss, I don't know which. I decided we needed to actually see this. So don't do drugs, kids. I made a word factory. Look at it. All right. I made a word factory. If you notice, the word, the Oh, so if poison goes in here, then it goes down the tube into the heart. This is a human heart. Into the mind and out the old word hole right there, your mouth. If honey goes in and into our hearts and then it hangs out in there and then it goes into our mind and then out your mouth, I want to prove to you something. You cannot put honey in here and expect poison to come out. Vice versa. You cannot put poison in and have that take root in your heart, go into your mind, that's where your words are formulated, and out your mouth. It's not possible. So how do we reverse engineer an increase in honey production? Is this making sense?
Yeah.
Is this a little odd? Good, I want it to be. But before you think that this is just Mike being weird, it's actually me making a physical representation of something that Jesus said. Let's look at it. Luke 6:45 says this, the good person out of the good treasure of his heart produces good, and the evil person out of the evil treasure produces evil, for out of the abundance of the speaks. That's actually not that complicated. So it's actually not a matter of willpower, is it? It's actually a matter of our heart. From the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Your words are not accidental. The things you type are not accidental. They are actually born here. I actually made a picture of this. So you could jot it down on your notes, or you could draw it in your notes on your phone or something. There's a very simple representation of this, but a way that you can draw it, because nobody can draw it. Well, maybe you can. You're amazing. All right. But that's easy to draw, and that's easy to remember. Or take a screenshot of it. Thank you. Go for it. Actually, it wouldn't be a screenshot. It would just be a picture. All right. Here's what I need you to do. I need you to put your hand over your heart. Everybody, put your hand, your right hand over your left heart, and just know this, that when the Bible talks about your heart, it's not just talking about your organ that's beating in your chest. You can put your hand down. The word heart is mentioned over 1,000 times in Scripture. It's important. If it's mentioned over 1,000 times, it's important. We better pay attention. But over 2,000 years ago when this was written, or approximately 2,000 years ago when this was written, your heart was how they referred to the core of who you are. This was the center of your physical and spiritual life. Your heart. Out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. It was not just the organ beating in your chest, but if we are going to reverse engineer more honey production, that means we need to reduce the amount of poison production coming out of here, the amount of poison going in here, and we need to increase the amount of honey and honey. Make sense? We just need to reverse engineer more honey production. So I'm going to point to three ways that these things actually start bubbling up and forming in our hearts. Three things that you can do that are practical. Because it's not just wishing for this to be better, it's actually making it better, this part of your life and my life. It's not wishing to be stronger, it's actually doing the work to make yourself stronger in this area. So here we go. I'm going to point to three things. There's probably more, but three things that I think are the culprits of why things get poisonous or honeyness in our hearts. Here we go. Three things. We got that list up there? Who we hang out with, how we process pain, how we process fear. Who likes going to movies? Who likes going to movies? Hands up. You like going to movies? Me too. Who likes getting there early, like 30 minutes early, watching the previews? Me too. You got your $97 popcorn, your Diet Coke, because you're watching your figure. I know. I know. I know. And you're like, oh, here I come. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's like a trash can of popcorn. No one needs that. No one needs that. And it's a small. So, do you think it'd be cool to see a movie trailer of your life 10 years from now? In a world where nothing is as it seems, it's Sally 10 years from now. You think that would be cool or no? Raise your hand if that would actually be cool to see a movie trailer of your life 10 years from now.
A day in the life.
Okay, hands down. Everybody else is like, don't show me that. Don't show me that. I will have let myself go, guaranteed. Guaranteed. I see a lot of Krispy Kremes in my future. I don't need to see that movie trailer, but I can actually do that, and it's not magic. Harry Potter's not around. It's not magic. It's actually science. So there's a famous speaker named Jim Rohn who came up with this concept. Well, he applied it to who we spend time with. It's called the law of averages. And he said, you will actually become the five people you spend the most time with. So you take the five people you spend the most time with. The five people, and it could be past or present. So I'm not just talking about the people you hung out with yesterday. I'm talking about the people throughout your life that you have spent the most time with that have had the biggest influence on you. Are those poison people or honey people? Because you know who they are. And you know which list they migrated towards, honey or poison. And you wonder why you are the way you are. A lot of it is a result of who you hang out with. You will become the average of those five people. You hang out with honey people, you'll become a honey. I mean, people will accuse you of being a beekeeper. You hang out with poison people, people will wear hazmat suits around you. Do not. That's the first one, who we hang out with. You ready for number two? How we process pain. All of us are instruments of pain. We give it out and we receive it. Some of us more than others. but it's a guarantee in life you will experience pain. And other people will experience the pain because of you and your words and your actions, the things you do, the things you fail to do. It's a guarantee. But how we process pain is what leads to poison taking root here or honey taking root here. Do you see pain as something to be avoided? You see pain as something to be scared of? You see pain as some kind of mistake in life? Does pain make you sad and mad? Or either or, sad or mad? Because that's what it does to most people. It makes us sad, it makes us mad. And we wonder, God, why are you letting this happen? What's going on? You must not care. Blah, 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 blah. Pain. Or do you see pain as a natural occurrence of life that actually is the only method to you getting stronger, to you getting wiser? You show me the strongest people in this room right now, and I guarantee you they've gone through the most pain with the right perspective. You show me bitter people in this room, they've gone through the most pain with the wrong perspective. Do you see pain as something that God is allowing in your life to make you stronger? You can go to the gym later and try to get swole by curling pencils. You're like, oh yeah. Oh yeah, look in the mirror, curl that pencil. You go out and sit in your car and you're like, I'm not stronger yet. Really? I know. Because you didn't experience any pain. There was no resistance. There was no tension. It was so simple. You want an easy life? Prepare to not be strong. It's okay. You can have an easy life. You won't be strong. It's perspective. The way we look at it, we say, God, I know you know what's going on here. I don't like that. I'm not saying you have to like pain. It's just having the right perspective about it. That God uses pain to make you stronger and wiser. Or how we process fear. The third one, how we process fear. Fear of the unknown, fear of yesterday and the shame that's behind me and the wake of destruction that's behind me. And oh, if that ever catches up with me, I'm a dead. Oh, if only if the skeletons in your closet, the fear of the present and what's going on inside you and around you and what's going on without you. And you're looking on Facebook and everyone's at the lake and you're like, must be nice, I'm at Walmart. Great. My life. Who would want my life? Or you're scared of the future because you can't control it and you're so used to controlling everything, but the future is out of your control and you don't like that and you're scared of it. Here's what it's actually a matter of trust. Do you trust that God has taken care of your past, which Scripture says He has? For Christ died once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring us to God. He made him to be sin who knew no sin, so you could become the righteousness of God. Okay, it seems like the sin thing and my past has been taken care of as far as the east is from the west, so God has separated you from, so it's I'm not actually on the hook anymore for the pain I've caused behind me. God has forgiven that. And the present, God says, here we go, Joshua 1:9. Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Oh, that's right. He'll be with me wherever I go. Also, God is outside of time. He exists outside of time. That's why he already knows tomorrow. He's been there. He's like, I know how this ends. I know what your tomorrow already looks like. Just trust me. It sounds like it's a matter of trust as it pertains to fear that's taking root in here and making your poison words come out. Who we hang out with, how we process pain, how we process fear. Is this making sense? I'm not talking about easy things here, but I am saying it's maybe more simple than we give it credit for. And I would rather have a honey-producing factory that works without me having to concentrate on it, because I have taken care to guard my heart from poison flowing in. and guard my heart from poison taking root because I'm processing things in a healthier way. Is this making sense? Yeah. I wonder sometimes what a well-functioning honey-making you would look like. Maybe it looks kind of like this.
Appreciate that.
So I just want to thank you for being a great dad. You're always there to support me, even when I say, no, I don't really need this talk right now, but you're there nevertheless, and it's always just great to have someone to rely on.
For the past 12 years, you've been my best friend, and I want to thank you for everything you've done for me.
You've always been there for me, my number one friend. I think we both know that this is going to go a lot farther than school.
Although I know we've only been married for a year and a half, I know I don't always acknowledge how awesome you are.
You have a great sense of humor. You're witty and sharp.
And you're a kind person and always thoughtful of others.
You're one of the sweetest, kindest, most thoughtful men and people in my life, and I really appreciate that.
And the whole time you were growing up, you made it so easy to be a mom. And I don't know if I've ever told you that.
You are absolutely beautiful, absolutely, and you are so, so talented. Keep doing what you're doing, because it is going to take you places.
Do we switch spots? Is that what we do?
Jackson?
Yes?
I'm so lucky that you're in my life today as not only a coworker, but as a friend. You're someone that inspires me every day just to keep a positive attitude and to laugh and smile and stay lighthearted.
I always really appreciate how you start singing at the drop of a hat, because you have such a beautiful voice, and I love the way that you filled my whole childhood with song.
First met you 12 years ago in kindergarten, and I'm so glad I did, because you've been my best friend ever since. It's the best, so thanks.
The compliment I want to give you today that I've never said to you before is your awareness of other people and how nice you are to everyone in the room.
You're very good at making everyone in a room smile, putting everyone at ease. I admire that so much in you.
You're honestly such an amazing person. You are my best friend in the world, and you always will be.
All I can say is that I really love you, and I don't know, it might be hard for you to believe because I don't act like it sometimes, but I do.
I like to say that I take after you because I think that you're just such a great person, and I aspire to be more like you as an adult. And I think that if I could be just like my mom, that would be the greatest gift I could have.
You're the most beautiful woman I know. I'm so blessed to have you in my life. I probably don't tell you that enough. Yeah.
It's not easy to consistently manufacture honey. I know. I'm not pretending that this is easy. What I'm saying is it's worth it. It's worth it. Your words have more powerful, or have more power than you give them credit for. Your honey that you could bring to any conversation has more power than you give it credit for. It's powerful. It can make a difference for somebody. Just the words you say to yourself can make a difference. And it's hard to do the right thing all the time, I know. It's hard to say the right thing all the time, I know. One thing I will guarantee you is that your willpower will run out. There's only so many self-help books you can read. It will run out. And if you find it really difficult to not have honey coming out your mouth more. If you're finding it really difficult, maybe, just maybe, this is the issue here, your heart. The Bible talks an awful lot about hearts. And when someone becomes a Christian, the Holy Spirit of God takes residence here. But not only that, but we hear in the book of Ezekiel, God says this very puzzling thing, but it's very beautiful. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. A heart that's alive is what he's saying. Many people do not have a heart that's alive spiritually. And here's the deal. You could be sitting here and you're just not sure. You're like, I've been coming to church a lot. Isn't that really what it's all about? No. Well, I've been reading a lot of like faith books. Isn't that what it's about? No. Well, I went to a Bible study one time. Isn't that what it's about? No. Well, I try to be a good person. Isn't that what it's about? No. I am married. I have a ring that I wear. And in August of 2014, I stood in front of a bunch of people and I made a commitment to Candace. Now, I could say I read a bunch of books about marriage and I've been to some weddings. That does not make me married. So maybe this is the issue. Maybe you've gone to church for a long time. Maybe you've just never sealed the deal with God. You're wondering why you still feel lonely, why you still feel rejected, why you still feel so much pain that you don't know what to do with, why you still feel so confused, frustrated, lost, like you're spinning your wheels, grasping for air, grasping at straws. You're wondering, when is this all going to make sense? Maybe, just maybe, your heart has never come alive in Christ. Maybe it's just never has, because you never really knew any different. You're like, I prayed a prayer when I was 4 at some camp. Well, why don't we just seal the deal? Don't play games with this. Walk out of these doors knowing, full on, no questions asked, that you are a Christian, which is not just lip service. It's something that has to happen here. So I'm going to pray. And you, I bet you already know who you are. You've played this game a while. Don't play games with this. It's too important. The best part of becoming a Christian is that life gets better now, immediately. You don't just get heaven someday down the road. You get Jesus now. You get forgiveness now. You get peace now. That's pretty amazing. And then God himself will get into your word factory and start manufacturing better things. If you want to pray with me, pray with me. Let's all close our eyes. Good morning, God. It's me. I admit I have failed you and failed myself. I've chased a life without you in the center of it, and I'm sorry. I don't want that life anymore. You are who you say you are, and you can do what you say you can, so you can make me whole. You can make me pure. You can make me into the version of myself I was always meant to be. You can do it. Please take over my life and guide me. I believe you died in my place to cancel the penalty of sin that I could never pay. I believe you came back from being dead, proving that even death was not more powerful than love. And God, I realize and I accept that you love me, and I love you too. Amen. Here's what I'll say. If you prayed that, you have to tell somebody. You have to tell somebody. It's that crucial. It's that crucial. Tell me after service. Come find me. Send me an email. I don't care. Tell me. Or tell a friend. Or go out those doors to the right to the well. There's a little room. Someone would love to just debrief this stuff with you. Don't play games with this. It's too important. Now, if you'll stand, we're going to sing the old faithful, Amazing Grace. And let's sing this like we've never sung. You just belt this thing out. I don't care if you're croaking. God doesn't say make a nice song. He said make a joyful noise. So let's sing this like people who realize what our mouths were built for in the first place, which is to give God glory.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saves a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was blind.